You're listening to KCAA, your good neighbor along the way.
Hello, and welcome to the Financial Wake Up Show. Each week, we explore and take a deep dive into awakening the financial abundance we all have inside of us. We educate and create awareness by focusing on fundamental principles of money, talking to business and community leaders about successful habits, while learning from each other how to build, protect, and create legacies. And now, here's your host, Daniel Choi.
And good morning to you. It's a new day, and with each day comes a new beginning, a new chance to do something great, learn something new, and enjoy everything this great life has to offer. If you have not already done so, go to the iTunes or Google Play, subscribe to the podcast. You can download all of our shows there. Also, subscribe to the show on YouTube. You can find all of this under the Financial Wake Up Show with Daniel Choi. Broadcasting live again on KCAA, 1050 AM, 106.5 FM, and 102.3 FM. I combine integrity with intelligence to wake you up to things you want to be doing financially. Check out our website, financialwakeupshow.com, or visit us on Facebook and Twitter. That's at TFWUS. If you have any doubt, just reach out. And on every show, we talk about three things. Number one, growing and protecting your wealth. Number two, exit planning, which is selling or transferring your business if you're a business owner, or retirement if you're an employee. And estate planning is last, which is creating a legacy while fully enjoying your money while you're alive. And before I get started on the show, I do have some good news to share. I forgot to mention it on last week's show. I got caught up into it. But recently, I was selected to and named to the Forbes Magazine Financial Council. And this is pretty neat. This means I get to meet with other hand-selected finance council members, discuss current issues, and ultimately, I get to contribute content, thought leadership articles, and tips for readers to the Forbes publications and online. I feel really excited about this. You know, if you think about it, there's over 400,000 licensed professionals in my industry nationwide, and there's less than 130 on the council in the whole country. So really excited about that. Just wanted to share with you that news. By the way, I'm very grateful for all the subscribers and listeners. I see the data, and we seem to be picking up momentum. So thank you for your listenership. In a January episode, I talked about starting a business and the considerations you have to make when starting that business. And I want to continue that today because it's more than just how you start the business. It's how you run it. And so many businesses I meet, they're working incredibly hard for their businesses. They're not aware of how that business can be working equally hard for them. And they're completely naked sometimes when it comes to protecting themselves legally, financially, personally. There's too much risk that's taken on. And running a business itself is risky enough. I mean, think about it. You have competition that's constantly springing up. You've got changing market conditions, economic cycles, etc. Why add more risk to your business by having it not set up correctly, proactively in advance? You know, not to mention, 9 out of 10 business owners have thought about exiting their business one day, but only 1 out of 10 have ever had a discussion about how they're going to exit their business with anyone. And successfully cashing out of your business, that's the dream, right? That is the whole point of the American dream, is to build a business to be able to successfully cash out. What that means is exiting properly without excess taxation, and that exit process planning is directly a result of the decisions you're making today. So today's Wake Up Now segment is, how should my company be set up in order to reduce my risk and ultimately exit successfully? And again, by successfully, I mean by getting your company, which is your creation through blood, sweat, and tears, to the people you want that business to go to preserve your hard work, your legacy, the brand you've built, with the least amount of fair taxation, because you're going to have to pay taxes, and giving you the resources you need to either start your next business or retire altogether. Now, I've seen doctors, restaurants, car body shops, mechanical companies, industrial firms, athletes that run their own businesses, family-owned businesses, even big corporations. And sometimes the way their companies are set up are misaligned to their long-term vision. They're misaligned to what the business needs. And it leaves their businesses and their families exposed to issues from a taxation and legal standpoint, sometimes even personally. I'll share a couple stories with you today. That means more legal fees, more headaches. None of that is good. Okay? And you've got enough on your shoulders running a business anyway. So one of the objectives I have for every client I work with is in regards to your taxation. You should be able to say this. You have a plan that allows you to pay your obligation of taxes based on your income and assets, but to also exercise every legal right, provision, benefit, and exclusion available to you through the IRS tax code to mitigate and control how much and when you pay those taxes. You should be able to confidently say that. And how you set up your business is a direct correlation to that. Okay, so there are five types of business entities I want to cover. Sole proprietorships, general partnerships, limited liability companies or LLCs, S corporations, and C corporations. And each of these five entities has tax, legal, and financial implications. And each of these also has a set of strategies that go along with it. Not to mention, each has a different exit plan when you decide to leave your business. And so I'm going to break each of these five down into categories. The first is how they help you add owners or get additional funding, investments. The second is how are you taxed in each of these. The third is the personal liability or risk that you would hold. And the last is the corporate accounting and filing formalities that are required. So let's start with a sole proprietorship. What this means is you own a business by yourself. So in terms of getting additional owners or getting funding, it's not very flexible. It's difficult to do because the sole proprietorship is exactly that. It's just you by yourself. You get taxed individually one time on your tax return. In terms of risk, legally, financially, you bear 100% of it. So you should have implementation of risk mitigation strategies for your personal assets in this case, because you're on the hook. There are no corporate accounting or filing formalities, so that's great. But the sole proprietorship, it's basically just allows you to do business. I mean, it gives you access to retirement programs through the IRS that regular W-2 employees don't get, so that gives you an advantage. But there's not really much other advantage. It's just kind of a license to do business. And what, you know, as soon as you start bringing on employees, as soon as you start thinking longer term, the sole proprietorship phases out pretty quickly as far as like its usage or its value to you, okay? So let's go to the next one, which is a general partnership. A general partnership is you and a partner or several partners. And in terms of bringing on new owners in the future, you can get those new owners. The contracts are set up that determine ownership percentages. Those contracts, please make sure they're written correctly. I have seen general partnership contracts that are one-page documents that basically say, I invested this much money and I own this percent. Well, it doesn't disclose what percent of the revenue, what percent of the assets, you know, the intellectual property, anything like that. It's just a one-pager, which obviously has a lot to be desired. If you want to get additional funding later or add owners later, it can get a little complex. It can cause legal issues. Why? Because it has to do with when your company is valued, when the partnership was originally formed, whether you have to dissolve that partnership and start a new one, and then ultimately what the company value is after the additional funding has come in from the new owners. So it's not as flexible as far as adding future value easily. Okay. Now, in terms of taxation, each partner's taxed individually. And I want to explain a concept to you called a pass-through taxation. Pass-through means that the taxes pass through the company and hit each owner individually on their tax returns. Now, generally speaking, this is a good thing because that means there's just a single taxation event. Okay. So in a general partnership, the taxes pass through and go to the owners in equal percentages. In terms of risk, each partner bears their share of the legal and financial risk. So again, just like a sole proprietor, you better have stuff in place to protect you, your personal assets, because you're on the hook. And there are, again, no corporate accounting and filing formalities, which is good. You know, it's almost the same as being a sole proprietor, being in a general partnership. You have access to the retirement programs I mentioned before, but now you got another person involved, and that causes issues. I'm going to talk about legal documents later in the show, but setting these up is extremely important because you've got another partner and their family involved. And I'll talk about that too. Because remember, when you're partners with somebody, it's not just you and that partner doing business. You're doing business with their entire estate and everyone who's involved. Okay, so that creates some conflicts sometimes, and we're going to talk about that. Okay, the third entity I want to talk about, limited liability companies, LLCs. These are an alternative to corporations and partnerships because they are kind of a hybrid. They combine the corporate advantage of limited liability protection, which is good, with the partnership advantage of a pass-through tax, meaning it just goes right through the company and hits your taxes once. Okay. Now, if you have a startup company and you think you're going to have losses for a couple years, and you want to pass those losses to yourself and the other owners, LLC could be a good program for you. It gives you flexibility for accounting methods because LLCs are not required to use certain accounting methods that C corporations or other corporations are required to do. Now, if your business owns real estate, we're going to talk about real estate in a bit and real estate ownership. I see a lot of people just owning investment real estate under their name, like a sole proprietor. There's a lot of risk there. But if you know that your business is going to own real estate, an LLC is a strong candidate for you as far as an entity. And then if you want management flexibility, LLCs are more flexible than corporations in terms of how you can structure the management of the business. Now, you do have to file incorporation documents to set up an LLC. It's not like a sole proprietorship or general partnership where you just file with the city hall, a business permit, and set up a DBA and announce that. An LLC, you've got to file with usually your state and pay the related filing fees. There are some ongoing formalities and obligations, but they're fewer in an LLC than other corporations. Okay, so let's break down how you add owners and get funding in an LLC. It's similar to a general partnership. Legal documentation, incredibly important. If you think you may need funding in the future, like big investors coming in, a general partnership and LLC, probably not a good fit overall. But it is good if you want to have flexibility for sharing profits among owners. So if you know you don't maybe need funding in the future, but you want flexibility for sharing among the people who are involved already, LLCs can be a good choice. Now with the tax status, again, the LLC itself is not taxed at the entity level. However, the LLC does have to complete what's called a partnership return if the LLC has more than one owner. Now the income or the loss is passed through, as I mentioned earlier, and it hits the individual owners, so the tax is paid just one time. Now, each partner does bear legal and financial risk. However, there is some protection. Therefore, the name Limited Liability Company. It is a separate entity, which means it can be sued as an entity if something goes south. If the LLC is set up correctly and funded well, legal and financial risk can fall on the shoulders of just the LLC, not the business owner. However, remember, anyone can sue anyone. And when you get sued, they're generally going to sue the biggest pockets. So when you have, let's say, two owners and they're doing well financially and maybe own other businesses, and you have an LLC that's underfunded and goes bankrupt, well, guess what? The two owners are going to get sued. I mean, you can't avoid that. You're with the LLCs, but the LLC does provide some legal protection there. And lastly, there are fewer obligations in corporate. Let's go to the S corporation. S corporation is a standard corporation. It's got special tax status with the IRS. So the formation requirements are the same as those for C corporation. So you've got to file with the state and the appropriate filing fees. But now you've got some additional tax benefits because S corp it is also as a pass through. Okay, so you want flexibility, let's say because you have employees now and you want to set salaries to minimize Social Security and Medicare, the S corporation is the way to go. Now, shares can be used to allocate new owners now. When you bring on new funding, it's a lot cleaner from a valuation standpoint. It's a lot cleaner when you're getting new funding. However, The number of shareholders you can have is limited to 100. And you can't have non-US owners. So if you're planning on getting funding from overseas, S-Corp's not for you. And there's one type of stock, which is a non-voting stock. Okay, so you can't have different types of shares, basically. S-Corporation, again, you're only taxed once. It's a pass-through, which is great. Each shareholder pays at their individual tax rate, up to 100 shareholders again. And it's also good because you're at lower risk of an IRS audit, because S-Corporations do have to file what's called an informational tax. And there's a higher audit rate for business income that's only reported on what's called the Schedule C. So if you want to lower that risk of an IRS audit, you can file an informational return with an S-Corporation that helps you out there. Now, if you get sued or you have legal obligations or whatnot, the risk is shouldered by the S-Corporation, which is great. But again, anyone can get sued. So that's part of our legal system. The last thing is there are more accounting regulations in place for S-Corporations. They are considered, unless they're considered small, which means your revenues are less than $5 million, you typically have to use a different type of accrual method for accounting, so there's some formalities there. And the last thing I want to cover before we go to break is the C-Corporation. That's called the Standard Corporation. And that's a totally separate legal entity owned by shareholders. And you form the corporation. There's a lot of articles that need to be filed with the states. You have to structure limits within each shareholder's personal liability. This is a great company or entity if you want venture capital or you know you need funding down the line. You want flexible profit sharing among the owners. You want company earnings to stay in the business so that it can grow, because again, now the corporation is standalone by itself. If you want flexibility to spread the business earnings and shareholders for tax planning, that's a good thing. Social Security, Medicare taxes, this is also good for C corporations. If you want to easily sell your business, C corporations are good. If you want to plan for travel and entertainment, C corporations are also good. Also, your individual IRS audit exposure is probably the least at this point, because now the tax return is on the shoulders of the C corporation. But that leads to one of the biggest drawbacks of a C corporation. There's a double taxation. Unlike the other entities I mentioned, there's a single taxation. There's a double taxation on C corporations, meaning the income is taxed at the corporation level first, and then you got to pay taxes again at the individual ownership level. Okay, so you've got no pass-through ability on the C-Corp. Now, as far as bringing on owners in the future, this is the best one if you want to get more funding. Why? Eventually, you could go public with the C-Corporation. That's a good thing. But ultimately, employees can buy into the stock. You can create incentive programs for them. There's an unlimited number of shareholders, which is great. You can have non-US owners, so if you want funding from overseas. You can have different types of stock, like preferred stock versus common stock, and the shareholders can vote in C corporations, which is good. There are, on the drawback side, a strict annual compliance and filing requirement, though. So all of these have pros and cons. When we come back from break, I'm going to talk to you about whether or not, based on what you want, is your business set up correctly. But let's go to our sponsors, listen to them for a little quick minute. You're listening to the Financial Wake Up Show with Daniel Choi on KCA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM.
When it comes to storing food for an emergency, you should buy the best. Food for Liberty is proud to be your source for the first ever organic line of storable foods from Numana. Our organic family bucket of 162 total servings of goodness. These organic, ready-to-serve meals have no preservatives, no GMOs, and best of all, are ready in an instant. What you put into your body during times of distress truly matters. The organic family bucket is the best storable foods you can buy. Clean, healthy, and packed with nutrition. Meals like organic classic chili, organic pasta primavera, organic pancake mix, and your kids will love the organic mac and cheese. With a 25-year shelf life, rest assured your family will be food secure in an emergency. Go to organicbucket.us right now and get your organic family bucket. That's organicbucket.us.
All right. So before we went to break, I was talking to you about the different types of entities and based on what you want for yourself, is your business set up correctly? So I'm going to lead off with a story. It's based on kind of a true story. So I don't want to disclose too much information, but we had a situation with a dentist that was in another state. Dentist had three locations. And was so big, they had four newer, younger dentists working for him. And all three locations were under one sole proprietorship. There was no LLC set up. The revenue of this business was over $3 million annually, which is pretty good, right? So this dentist decides to go on vacation for a couple weeks. And during that vacation, 66-year-old client comes in, was given a treatment without, you know, understanding the charts correctly, the patient died. So the family sues, of course. Would the family sue the younger dentist who just finished school, probably had not much on the assets side? No, of course not. They sue the main dentist. $8 million settlement as a result of the lawsuit. All three businesses were liquidated. The dentist's home, retirement accounts, personal assets, all at risk. He had no protection in place and unfortunately had to rebuild everything from scratch. Now, what could he have done? Well, first of all, he could have set up three separate entities for all three different locations. That way, the location that was hit with this lawsuit would have been the only one at risk. He could have had personal umbrella insurance, so his home would have been protected. He could have had other legal documents in place to make sure that he's exempt from some of this stuff. Now, he still might have gotten sued. I'm not saying he wouldn't have gotten sued, but there's ways he can mitigate other things. Now, let's say he wanted to bring these younger dentists on as partners. Now, obviously, the one that didn't do well with the patient, he probably wouldn't. But let's say he did. Well, he would have wanted to have set up as an S corp, but he didn't do that. Would he need to be a C corp? Probably not. But I've seen a lot of small businesses, for some reason, set up as C corporations, paying unnecessary legal and accounting fees when it has nothing to do with what they're trying to do longer term. So you ever wonder why a successful business shuts down? Like, you ever drive by and say, gosh, that place, they had good stuff or good food or good offerings. And you're wondering, why did they shut down? Or sometimes they've been around for a long, long time. And they suddenly go out of business. What was it? I mean, sometimes it's money related and running the business related, but many times there's some sort of risk that caught up with them in a negative way, and they were unable to protect or handle that risk. And that's the bottom line. So I'm going to share with you risks that you got to be aware of as running a business and why entity formation is so important. The first one, lawsuits. I've already talked about this a couple of times, but you've got to make sure your contracts are fit to your situation, which includes leases, invoices, disclosures, protection of your intellectual trade secrets. You gotta have all this stuff written for you and pay the extra money to make sure legally it's set up correctly, because you don't wanna be downloading templates from Google or some online legal resource to just have this stuff in place. Okay, I've seen a lot of do-it-yourself investment real estate people who bought some investment real estate, use a lease document from online. And you're really putting yourself at risk there. So lawsuits is number one. Number two, partners. When you have partners, you have to protect yourself. Even if you're happy and holding hands and everything is great right now, you're dancing in a circle. Imagine this, your partner after 10, 15 years gets divorced. The spouse of the partner is not a happy camper. But guess what? Because you don't have an agreement in place, that divorce partner now has a 50% split with an unhappy spouse, who's now your partner, by the way, because they just inherited 50% of that share. Do you think running the business will be easy then? How about this? Your partner has other business deals and goes bankrupt. Okay? How are you going to deal with that? What if your partner is the one running the store or running the business and you're a silent partner, just funding the money, and they're driving home and get into a car accident? Who's going to run the business? I have seen very well-to-do investors putting money into businesses that are run by one or two people, and they don't have any protection in place if something happens to those one or two people. What if that partner gets addicted to drugs or has a health issue? What if they get into legal trouble and go to jail? What if they die? You know what? Let's not even talk about these horrible things. What if you just have a disagreement? What if this happy-go-lucky arrangement, just after a while, doesn't go very well, and you start butting heads? This is all covered by what's called a buy-sell agreement. You have to have a buy-sell agreement in place or some sort of incorporation document that spells out what happens in a partnership in each of these things. And set up these agreements in advance when you're on good terms. Don't do this when you're in the middle of an issue, because guess what? You're not holding hands anymore. Things are going to be tougher. The negotiations are going to be tougher. And again, if your partner just got divorced and you're trying to figure this out then, good luck. Okay? Now, third risk, creditor protection. If one location goes financially belly up, why put your other locations at risk? If one real estate property has a bad market and it goes under or it doesn't recover as quickly, let's say, as it does in California, why are you going to put your personal residence and your other real estate investments at risk? Don't do that. Creditor protection is extremely important to protect each of the segments of your business from each other. Okay, it's not like this thing where you're going to set up five locations of your business and all five are going to knock a home run every time. Okay, and the last risk is what's called a business continuity plan. What that means is, if you're a key person or you have key people in your business, what happens when you're not there? What if you have a great manager or vice president and they go on maternity leave? What if one of your best people that you've groomed since they came out of college leaves and joins your competitor because your competitor pays a little bit of cash up front? Okay? How is that going to affect you? And how is your business going to continue? You've got to stress test your situation. It's that important. Okay? Now, all of this ties to what I call exit planning. And I've talked about this. This is one of the things. But, you know, I'll be honest. Most of the shows I've done and talked about exit planning on is on the employee side. Today, I'm really going to talk about exit planning on the business side. And the first key to exit planning on the business side is you've got to be able to build your business value up. And how do you do that? There's something called excess cash flow. What is excess cash flow? Well, take your gross revenue as a business. You subtract out the real estate costs. You subtract out the salaries. You subtract out the debt. You subtract out the interest and amortization and any operating expenses. And what you have left is what's called excess cash flow. It's the extra cash you have at the end of the year. And by the way, that's the money that gets taxed. And without planning, here's what I see all too often with business owners. They go ahead and pay the tax, and then they just pay themselves a bonus or give themselves extra salary. Or they get a retirement plan suggestion and throw it into something like a SEP or a simple IRA or something like that. And then with the rest of the money, I've seen people just go out and buy a boat or a camper trailer or a new truck or something like that. Now, instead of sending that money to the IRS, here's some alternatives you could do. First, you could protect you and your key people from the stuff I mentioned earlier. That might be pretty valuable to you, no? Rather than going to Uncle Sam. You could buy additional equipment instead of leasing it. Maybe that makes sense for you. Maybe not, but you could explore. You could invest in research and development. You could go look at other areas to invest in terms of real estate. You could do that instead of paying more taxation. You could buy some commercial real estate, maybe instead of paying rent to somebody, buy the building or buy a building. Might be a lot more affordable than you think based on the taxes you're paying. You could set up more creative retirement planning. I'm really, really seeing so many times generic retirement planning in place for business owners. I just had a meeting 2 weeks ago with a business owner who said, why do I have this 401k? It's not fitting my needs. I don't know why I set it up. My employees aren't even taking part. It's too many of these generic retirement plans. Get it specialized. You could set up better benefits for your employees using that money that's going to the IRS. Why not reward them with better benefits? Retain those key people from leaving to a competitor. And the last thing you could do is create incentive programs for your employees. How about instead of just paying them cash, which of course cash is king, but giving them shares of the company or creating bonus programs or, hey, if you stay with me for the next 5 or 10 years, I'll give you this amount of money. There are ways to create what I call golden handcuffs. Golden handcuffs allow you to keep the money that, keep the employees in your business and away from competitors who may want to poach them away. All right. So my question to you is, how is your excess cash flow building your business up? How is it building it up? Is it building it up at all? And running a business, who's the person you're consulting with on this? Because many times you're focused on doing what you do. Okay, whatever that is, whatever successful business you're running, that's your focus. Well, all these risks, all these financial things, all these legal things, are sitting there on your plate. So let's now fast forward. Assume your business is growing. Well, exiting is cashing out of that business. And there's a very interested party when you cash out. That person is the IRS. And then after you pay the IRS, the remainder has to be able to fund either your next business or your retirement. And that's why we work. That's why we live the American dream, to do that, right? So let's talk about the most common ways to exit. The first, family members. You want to give it to a family member. Okay. First of all, this isn't as easy as it sounds. Children, I have two, they grow up differently. Some of them have different skills and traits. And some may want to be a part of your business. Some may not want to be a part of your business. But how do you treat them equally? I mean, you can't just gift a $2 million business to one child and leave the other two out. Or maybe the other two want to be a part of business, but you know that they don't have the skills to do it. And here's the other thing. I've seen a lot of times where the use of a promissory note comes in, where because the younger family member doesn't have the cash to buy you out, right? They don't have money to just give you all the money you need for your next business or retirement. So you use these things called promissory notes. That's like the default way to do it, which means I'm going to pay you back over time. And I'll tell you, this can be one of the worst ways to transfer a business. Why? Because the departing owner, which is typically you, bears a ton of risk. What if the business doesn't do well after you leave? So guess what happens? The departing owner doesn't actually end up leaving the business. They stick around to keep the business going and ultimately collect on those promissory notes, because without the business doing well, the promissory note is worth nothing. And not to mention, for this to work, the business value has to be high so you can cash out on these promissory notes. And guess what? The IRS capital gains are going to hit you hard because your business is valued as high as it could be. Okay? So some considerations there. Now, next, some people may want to give it to some key employees. That can work too. But do you have employees that can afford this? Are they going to mortgage their house to buy you out? Okay, maybe you don't, but here's the second question. Do you even want them to run your business that you spent 20 years building? Are they motivated to run the business? They're almost like your children in determining if they are capable of having the leadership and the vision to build like you did, to keep it going. I've never met a business owner who just does not give a care for what happens to their business when they leave. They do care. There are relationships built. And giving it to a key employee group could work. They could buy you out. But again, I've seen also sometimes where promissory notes are used and you run into the same issue, okay? Third way to exit, IPOs. IPOs, initial public offerings, you're going public, you're issuing stock on an exchange. And these are generally reserved for very large companies that have very large revenues. Why? Because the issuing of stock, when companies sell stock, it's to raise money. Well, what's that money going to be used for? Is your business the type of business that even, makes it valuable for an investor to put money into? So for example, the dentist, like I mentioned earlier in the show, they're not going to go IPO because there's no business model to support the reason for extra funding from a stock offering, not to mention it's expensive. Okay. Now, there are employee stock programs. So this allows employees to buy stock, which cashes you out, gives you money to retire or buy your next business. Well, the problem still remains, who's going to run the company? Okay, employees are buying the stock, which is great, they own the company, but who's going to fill that leadership gap? You've got to groom that next leader. That's a big part of this. Now, the fifth way I've seen is what's called a third-party acquisition. Somebody comes in and buys. This is the most common way I've seen people leave their businesses outside of family members, but it's also the most messed up I've seen. Well, let's discover why. First of all, there's usually the wrong valuation or no valuation on the business done at all, which is, in my mind, a little bit crazy, but I have seen people make handshake deals. Hey, I understand your business is for sale. I'll give you 600 grand for it. And the parting owner says, or the seller says, sounds good. Can you give me 650? And the buyer says, sure, here's 650. There's no valuation done. Okay. There's no contingencies in these deals. They use an escrow company, but there's no arrangements to keep key people in place to protect trade secrets. You know, banks have relationships in terms of loans. Maybe they don't want relationships with the new buyer. There are vendor relationships where you get your supplies. Maybe they don't want to continue to do business with the new owner. All these things have to be put in place when you sell to a third party. Not to mention, there are processes called controlled auctions where you can bring in brokers or investment bankers who can shop your business, get a better value for it. So not only should you do a valuation, you should make sure you're getting the best deal, that people are able to bid for your business. And that is a best practice. So I'll give you a story. There's a well-known brewery that was offered $500 million to sell their company to a much larger conglomerate, a beverage company. And the owners sat around and said, $500 million? No, we enjoy what we're doing. We're not going to do it. 3 weeks later, they came back, the larger conglomerate, for $1 billion. They doubled the offer in 3 weeks. And so the owner says, yeah, we'll take it. And the question I have for you, is that a good deal? Now you might be thinking, well, $1 billion, yeah, that's a good deal. Sure. But if a huge conglomerate beverage company came back in 3 weeks with double the offer, that means their internal finance team had a much higher value. That's why they were so easily able to come back with double the offer. Which means the owners probably could have gotten more, but didn't follow a proper exit planning process and just kind of took a deal. So it was like a handshake deal on a bigger scale, right? And the last way to exit your business is the worst, which is liquidation. You just sell off the assets, sell off the, you know, liquidation sales. You've seen them. This is least desirable because you really don't get anything longer term for it. You just get cash for today. The business is gone. And a lot of times, unfortunately, this is a result of a lack of planning, exit planning. There was no laid out vision for how we want to cash out at the biggest price. Now, I mentioned early in the show, 9 out of 10 business owners have thought about exiting their business, but only 1 out of 10 has ever had a discussion about it. So the question is this, which exit are you considering? And is your business set up correctly? Are you a small family business set up as a C corporation where you're never going to get additional funding and don't plan on having other owners? Or are you a business that has a huge growth potential, but you're sitting there as a general partnership running multiple locations with no buy-sell agreement? Are you healthily growing your business? Do you have key people that you're grooming and developing for leadership positions? Are you protecting yourself? And by yourself, I'm talking about your retirement, your home, from the business risks. I've talked about all these today. So the be aware or beware tip of the week is be aware of the decisions you're making with regards to your business and how it's set up from an entity standpoint. Be aware you're making decisions around taxation, risk, whether you can get funding, future partners, and setting yourself for accounting fees and requirements that you may not be aware of. You could be bleeding money away while you're working so hard to grow your business. Be aware you're setting the table up for an exit plan. And by the way, if you haven't done an exit plan, you're just going to default to whatever's given in front of you based on the decisions you've made many years before. Or beware, you could end up cashing out for a lot less after all those years of work. Make it count. We all think about the next stage. But as business owners, who do you consult with? Have your advisor. If you have any doubt, just reach out. Daniel@financialwakeupshow.com. You know my email. You know my website. This is our 20th show. And I know there's questions you might have. Just reach out. At the very least, confidential information is at your fingertips. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to do our Give More to Get More segment when we come back. You're listening to the Financial Wake Up Show with Daniel Choi, KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM.
Do you have $10,000 or more in outstanding federal student loans? You may qualify to have your entire student loan forgiven with one free call. That's right. If you're a teacher, police officer, firefighter, or work for a nonprofit, you may qualify for new federal programs to have your entire student loan forgiven. Graduate Service Center wants to give you free information on all the programs that can help. The sooner you call, the faster you can get relief. Get the maximum loan forgiveness, loan reduction, or consolidation available. Plus, find out in the first free call what you qualify for. A loan forgiveness specialist is standing by to answer all of your questions for free. Stop worrying about student loan payments. If you have $10,000 or more in federal student loans, this information could change your life. Call 800-315-9956. 800-315-9956. Wipe out your federal student loan debt. Find out how. Call 800-315-9956. 800-315-9956.
And every week, you know, I like to highlight a nonprofit to end the show. Why? Because with all these financial strategies and things, if you don't give more in life, I don't believe you can get more in life. So, on this week's Give More to Get More segment, I want to welcome Citizens Climate Education Executive Director Mark Reynolds. During his years as a private sector trainer and consultant, Mark worked to maximize personal and organizational effectiveness in a variety of fields. Today, he uses those skills to empower ordinary citizens to educate influential stakeholders about the benefits of national climate solutions. Globally recognized expert on helping disparate interests find common ground on energy, public policy, and the environment. He's appeared before the Yale Project on Climate Change Communication, ARDE, Power Shift, and in the last 5 years has spoken in front of over 7,000 people. He oversees a training curriculum. He's been on TV and radio shows. Here's another one he's on. He's written op-eds in a number of different print journals, 85 to be exact. But it's my pleasure to welcome Mark to the show. Mark, how are you doing this Saturday morning?
Thank you, Daniel.
I want to start with just a very general question. What is the mission of Citizens Climate Education Lobby?
Can I say one thing first before that regarding
sure.
your previous segment? I was a small business owner who sold to a publicly traded company.
Yes.
And boy, would I have liked to have had a practice run before I did that. It turned out okay, but it could have turned out a lot better.
Well,
the mission of Citizens Climate Education is to create the political will for a livable planet by empowering citizens to have breakthroughs in their personal and political power. And what that basically says is that there are particular models for generating political will so that the politics, if done effectively, can become an inevitability, for instance, on our issue, climate change. And so what we're doing is simply training citizens in that model so they're exerting influence on the process.
That's very timely, given some of the
yes.
issues we've seen in the recent news. What's the history of your organization? How did it come to form? And tell us about that.
Yeah, so our founder is a gentleman named Marshall Saunders, who actually spent 20 years setting up microcredit loans. And some people have heard of Muhammad Yunus, who won the Nobel Peace Prize for setting up the microcredit process, where you lend money to the poorest of the poor people in the world, and they actually empower themselves by starting a small business in their community and lifting themselves up out of poverty. He had generated over 1 million microcredit loans when he realized that climate change would probably undo most of that. And that, you know, microcredit law is done in some of the most vulnerable, exposed communities like Bangladesh, Mexico, South America, et cetera. And so he realized that if he didn't do something about climate change, it was very likely that the work that had been to help poor people help themselves would be undone. And fortunately for us, the time he'd been working on microcredit, he'd been doing it in partnership with an organization called Results. Results is an extreme poverty advocacy organization. And what they proved is that you can work effectively with Congress. And the way you can work effectively with Congress is you have to form groups by congressional district so that the member feels support back home with their local voters. You have to give people a very strong structure of support, so if they did something last month, they'll do something this month. Results started asking the U.S. Congress 35 years ago to increase their annual appropriation to deal with worldwide poverty, which we used to give as a country about $25 million. We've been giving between $500 million and $2 billion for the last few years, and if you talk to members of Congress, they'll tell you it's because the Results volunteers are so effective.
Wow.
What we said is we're going to build an exact replica of that, but on the issue of climate change. So 6 years ago, I came to the organization. There were six groups and 24 active volunteers. There's now 383 chapters and 50,000 volunteers, and we've been able to do some really interesting things. So everybody says Congress doesn't work together, and particularly on this really difficult issue of climate change. But last year, we started something called the Climate Solutions Caucus in the House of Representatives, which you can only start with one Republican and one Democrat at a time. So there's now 15 Republicans and 15 Democrats who are working together on climate solutions. Last week, we also got launched the Republican Climate Caucus that has 17 Republicans saying we need to take leadership on climate. We've always believed you can't get a legislation pact in the U.S. without either bipartisan or introduced by Republicans, because every time Democrats introduce a bill, it becomes partisan. So we've been working very hard to build support in every congressional district.
That's fantastic. 50,000 volunteers, that's amazing. Now, you mentioned some of the things that you've been doing in light of some of the recent developments. I know President Trump has rolled back some of the protection that was put in place for the environment, but also, you know, has talked about his opinion around climate change and that sort of thing. What has your organization done with regards to those developments in the recent 6 months or so?
Yeah, our pathway to legislation was always through Republicans in Congress, so I think we're probably the only organization where that didn't change anything for us. We had been working to encourage and show Republicans that if they stepped out on this issue, which all the polling says the public is supportive of, that they would be supported in their district. You know, Trump is obviously a wild card, and what he said about the environment, you know, he could say something completely different next week. Nobody knows that, and he doesn't know it either, I don't think. So we've continued to work on the path we've set, which is building Republican support. So it was important for us to continue to build the bipartisan Climate Solutions Caucus to get the 17 Republicans from the House coming out saying that that they need to show leadership on the issue. So we haven't wavered at all. It can be disconcerting to pay attention to some of the things he says, but he might say something completely different the next week, so I just try not to pay attention to it.
You know, this is very timely, and I'm glad we've got you on the show to promote this. How do our listeners get involved? What resources do you need? You know, you've got 50,000 volunteers, but what does that exactly mean?
Yeah, so, you know, we have a bare-bone staff of 21 staff, and we staff up just enough to make sure that our volunteers are essentially doing everything. So, you know, we have conferences. I'm at a regional conference in Iowa right now. We have a national conference where we'll have about 1,000 people in June, and we'll see over 500 at the 535 congressional offices. We have a lot of support structure that does training for the organization. It's essential that our people are highly trained, even though they're functioning as volunteers. So, you know, people could support our organization. Go to Citizens Climate Lobby or citizensclimateeducation.org. There's a support us button you could hit that people could just join as a supporter. They could donate if they wanted to. Just knowing that, you know, if you look at, we have a budget of about $2.5 million. When you talk to the big groups that work on climate, their budgets are usually the $100 to $200 million a year, some $300 million.
Wow.
And when we share with them that last year our volunteers conducted over 1,200 meetings with congressional offices, got almost 3,000 letters to the editor published, over 500 op-eds, and about 50 meetings with the editorial boards and thousands of outreach events, they're shocked that you could do that with a volunteer organization because their method for dealing with this issue has been to spend money on it. Our method has been to chose to empower citizens and to give citizens a chance to actually express their citizenship at a greater level. You know, there's somebody said once, paying your taxes and voting isn't enough to call yourself a citizen. You've got to have a little more skin in the game. Mm-hmm. And what we really are is essentially a support structure to give citizens who want to engage, who don't want to just sit on the sideline and complain about a government, a way to actually have access to it and work with their elected officials.
That's a very powerful message and way to run the organization as well to empower the people. Can you share with the listeners again the website where they can go?
Yes, the simplest would be citizensclimatelobby.org.
Okay.
But then there's also citizensclimateeducation.org. They will get a lot more information from citizensclimatelobby.org.
Okay.
We actually have two entities. And so Citizens Climate Lobby is where most of the information is, but they could also go to citizensclimateeducation.org also.
Great. And for you personally, what's been the most rewarding aspect of your involvement with the organization over the last 6 years?
You know, the thing that has been most rewarding is finding out how much it lights people up when they choose to reject the kind of cynical view of legislators and government. You know, we set up one rule 8 years ago that said if you're going to meet with an elected official, the basis that we're doing if you volunteer through this organization is going to be admiration, respect, and gratitude for their public service. And it's really been incredibly gratifying to see that if you give people permission to actually treat people the way they want to, and particularly the people that people tend to regard in the lowest view, which is politicians, if they say, I'm going to take a bigger view of that, and because this is my country, this is my government, what it's done to those people, not only in their civic engagement, but kind of the impact it's had broadly across their life, has been extremely gratifying. Now, the fact that we actually have a really good chance of passing meaningful legislation is also very, very important because the scientists tell us we don't have a ton of time left to get an effective price on carbon. But just seeing the personal impact it's had on people has been remarkable.
Well, I appreciate so much the light you've shed on this very important subject and being a part of the show. We're grateful. CitizensClimateLobby.org, folks. That's where you want to go. Mark, I hope you enjoy the rest of your weekend. Thank you for being a part of the show.
Thanks a lot, Daniel. And I loved the previous segment. It was so pertinent to 20 years ago of my life.
Thanks again. Thanks for that, too. Okay.
All right.
So we're at the end of another episode. And, you know, we heard a lot of good things today from Mark. Before that, you know, I talked about business owners. And let me tell you why I'm so passionate about this. Business owners are the lifeblood of our economy. They're what makes the American dream. A lot of people come to this country just to run businesses and to have that opportunity. And you've seen from technology to biotechnology to the mom and pop shops to restaurants to people starting from nothing on really bare bones budgets, making it. And if we can create more education around increasing that chance to make it. And a lot of it has to do with legal, financial, and personal risk that's taken by business owners and just not aware of it. So call me, talk to me, ask questions. If you want to reach me off the air, it's 8507-WAKE-UP, 8507-WAKE-UP. My website, financialwakeupshow.com. Email me for any questions, daniel@financialwakeupshow.com. Yeah, you can go to the Facebook and Twitter account, send me direct messages. I get questions there sometimes. You know, at the very least, everything I discuss with people is confidential. It's complimentary. As Mark had mentioned, it would have been good for him to look at that. Maybe it's good for you to look at that. So until next Saturday, I wish you health, wealth, and prosperity. You've been listening to the Financial Wake Up Show on KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. Have a great weekend.